Thanks for coming to this talk. I know there's a really hard competition at the moment. And we will just close the door and you can understand me better. Okay, this talk is about KD Frameworks 5 on Android. If you wonder what this KF5 means, I'm talking about the progress we did in the last 2 years and also a lot about work in progress. I will start with a little bit talking about me and then giving a roadmap of this talk and then directly starting with it. So my name is Andreas Kattlandwehr. You can find me at a lot of IRC channels with the nickname Cola. I'm within the KDE project since about 6 years. This spring I finished my PhD in algorithm game theory and network creation games. If you want to know more about that, you can ask me in the break. Since then, I started working at Class E-System. That's a company that's doing these big, nice machines. And if the picture's not that good, but you can find me at the picture there in the cabin. It's a really nice, big thing. Wherever this talk is about my KDE involvement, so it's my KDE hat on today. And I want to talk specifically about how can we deploy KDE Frameworks 5 on Android, how can we use them there. And probably also at the beginning, what are KDE Frameworks 5? Then I will give a high-level introduction, what do I mean with a Qt and Android application? And then I'm getting to the main part of this talk about our approach, how to get the KDE Frameworks 5 there, how do we tool chaining, how do we set up a build system, or how do we provide easy-to-use build system, the availability of frameworks, and of course, quality assurance and continuous integration. And then I will talk about what is on the plate right now. So, KDE Frameworks 5. If you never heard about that, you could either ask David, the maintainer, or you, look at the websites, or I will try to explain to you. In the world some years ago when we had the KDE 4 times, we had this big monolithic KDE Ellipse library. And then we started to split these libraries to parts that really fit a problem, or that really are problem specific. So nowadays here we have a big set of libraries that address certain problems, like creating an archive, like getting more proxy models for your widget-based application, or doing localization, like KI18N. Since these libraries might have dependencies with other KDE libraries, we introduced something we called tiers, which means all frameworks that are at tier 1 only depend on Qt and must not depend on any other framework. So for you, the message to take home is, in an ordinary C++ application, you can take any tier 1 framework and use it. And you know you don't have a dependency to any other framework. That's awesome. And that extends you or your application with a certain functionality. And that with a really small footprint on memory and that stuff. These frameworks are available on, of course, Linux, Windows, macOS. We have monthly incremental releases, so you get patches really fast, and you know you only get small changes with each release that's well tested. Everything is LGPL 2+1+ license, so you could even use it in automotive. We have CMake as a build system, but we also support people who want to use QMake, so we ship pre and profiles. So in general, that's something that's a really interesting thing for any Qt developer who has problems like solving certain tasks and can simply take the library, put it into his or her application and get new functionality. These libraries are not only interesting on, the old platforms, but also in the mobile world. And that's why we are looking at Android. A typical Android application is written in Java, and in many cases, there's probably no reason to use any C++ library. And probably in such cases, you shouldn't do it. But there are reasons when you really want to introduce and use a C++ library. That might be that you have a specific functionality that is already implemented in C++, well-tested, is really fast, and you don't want to write this functionality again from scratch in another language, since you already have it. That's a valid, very valid reason to use such a library that possibly brings business logic that you want to use again. Another reason that's mostly within the KDE project, where we have applications, also small applications like in KDE Education, that are well fitted to be provided on Android devices, since that's really a possible target platform, where you don't want to write the whole application from scratch. You want to only adapt it a little bit, possibly write a new UI that fits to a mobile device, and then port it to it. And for that reason, you need such libraries that you already depend on, since you don't want to cut a functionality out, you want to port it. And that's a second main reason why we try to provide as many as possible frameworks on Android, at least such frameworks that make sense on Android. And I hope you are now with me that it's reasonable to use, that there are reasonable use cases for Frameworks 5 on Android. Before I go deeper into the talk, I want to give a small, really high-level understanding of what an Android or what a Qt on Android application is. And it's probably not completely accurate, but it's enough to know what we're doing here. So from a really high level, an Android application is simply this zip archive, this APK file that contains some Android-specific parts, like a manifest file into it in a well-defined folder structure, but that also can contain C++ libraries, so some shared libraries. And, well, that's what we consider as an Android application, where you have several layers. In the center, you have the Android part, the Java part, then you have possibly some C++ parts, and somewhere there's also the Qt part. Creating such an application takes a lot of tooling, some tooling. There are three important tools for creating such an application. That's the SDK, the NDK, and the Qt on Android framework. The SDK is used for, I think, any Android application that has libraries, that has an emulator, that has a debugger, that has anything, any tooling to really create an Android application. That's not really interesting for us. We only use it. The more interesting stuff is the NDK. That's a native development kit. That provides us with the with the power to use C++ libraries. It gives us the tooling to use GCC and Clang. It gives us the standard libraries that we need on such a platform. For example, a version of the standard C library that is unfortunately only a really cut short version called Bionic and lacks a lot of functionality, but that's the version we need, and other basic libraries. And that's what we are usually operating on. So we have this NDK with the sysroot, with a compiler toolchain, and on that we can compile our C++ libraries and applications that are then embedded into an Android application. And to make everything nicer to use, and also to embed Qt, there is a Qt on Android framework that on the one hand provides a platform abstraction layer. So you can consider it like another box that you can draw around the picture I put at the right side. And that also provides interfaces to directly operate deeply with the Android core. There's that's called the Java Native Interface, and Bogdan Batra, the founder of the Qt on Android initiative years back and still in the KDE project, will talk about it at Sunday. And I think that will be a really deep, interesting technical talk. So that's all I want to explain about what's roughly in Qt on Android application. And going to the more interesting stuff of this talk. Namely, how we try to provide Frameworks 5 on Android. And for that, I want to talk about four topics. The tool chaining, the build environment, the well, availability, already the availability of frameworks and our plans for quality insurance. If you ever looked at Qt and Android, you know it's using QMake. However, in the KDE community, we usually prefer CMake. And that's the reason why we start to look into a CMake tool chaining for creating Qt and Android applications. CMake has a built-in mechanism for doing cross-compilation. That's called a toolchain file. And such toolchain files define something like the compiler, the compile flex, where the sysroot is with all the libraries you want to link to. And such a toolchain file we are currently shipping with the extra CMake modules, which is released alongside with the Frameworks 5. It is a set of extra features for CMake that already gives you nearly already completely set up system for doing cross-compilation for Android. For this toolchain file, you only have to set the passes to the SDK, the NDK, and where Qt is found. And this toolchain finds and automatically defines for you the compiler, the linker flex, the linker, the link libraries, and also adds a target to generate an APK file out of it. So if you only use our toolchaining file, everything should work. And, well, I put the comment there, that's usually all you need to do, and also adds a path to your source code. Then you already get your make target and can simply do make APK package, and you have your APK file out of your application. And you can look up the documentation at that link below. And that's everything we need to use from CMake and from the toolchaining. Of course, we have the alternatives where you use QMake, where you use a really nifty Qt Creator integration that we currently, unfortunately, still lack for CMake. That would be really nice to see in KDevelop at one time, I think, or also Qt Creator possibly. But currently, we are more living on the on the shell interfaces and doing command line code. The second point is we want to make it easy to start working on Qt and Android application. It usually takes a lot of time to download all these tools like Qt and Android SDK NDK, install it at the correct passes, and also configure these things. And the SDK has a lot of stuff you can install and really put it at the correct places. And to make that easy, we simply introduced a Docker container to doing all of that. And using this Docker container is most simple. I put all four commands that you need to use it on that slide. You need to clone a repository where you only find a Docker image file and a small set of scripts, such scripts that we use for setting up the SDK script for correctly extracting the Qt 5. Well, we can't use Qt 5.6, Qt 5.6 in Android, and installing it at the correct location. Then you build a Docker image, you create it to use, and then you log in. And usually you also mount a local folder where you have all your sources or external things and want to put your APKs later on. So just writing these four commands and you have a ready set up build system to do cross-compilation. And to make life more easy, we already set the environment that all the parses are already set up. And we already configured KDE source build, which is a nice utility we use in the KDE community to build packages from source. You can even use it to compile everything of KDE. You can use it and build arbitrary libraries and applications. We set it up in a way with a configuration file that you can build all frameworks that are all available on KDE on Android yet. And that's also already set up. So you create this Docker image, you run this one liner, and you have all available libraries already compiled. they're installed in a shared install folder, and from there you can simply use it for your Android application. And I think that's already a nice way to to start development. And I thought it from some people who recently looked at it, that it's really easy to start. However, we are still lacking a little bit of IDE integration. So what do we have today? Today, we know for several frameworks that they already work on Android. I parted them in, I think, three groups. First part, I said, well, they're solving basic tasks, for example, the Etika framework, which gives you a nice, cute API to talk to the open collaboration services. For example, something Sebas will talk tomorrow in the store, KDE store talk. And what you find nowadays at kdeapps.org, I think, or com. So this open collaboration service API from the interface that you can simply use. The probably most used and most requested framework is SNK Archive. That gives you a really nice, really good integration for extracting and packaging stuff. And with a lot of file formats, and it simply works. And it's used in so many applications, and I think also many applications outside of the KDE project. We have kconfig, which is, I think, an advanced version of Qt setting. It provides a different approach and provides you with really persistent, platform-independent app settings. Kcodex is coming more from the PIM people, people looking at different encodings, for example, at mails, and doing a lot of encoding conversions. If you ever encounter such problems, look at Kcodex, and you have out-of-the-box solution probably for you. Kcordons is something that's probably of most interest within the KDE community, since it's already used in a lot of projects since, it gives convenience add-ons to Qt Core. For other projects outside, it's probably always a question, do I want to rely on another framework? If yes, you get a lot of nice functionality that you can simply use. It's always a question if it's worth another dependency. K-image formats, if you have a lot of image formats that you want to export from Q-image, that there are more. And with that, we have a really nice high-level multi-threading library that does a job-based multi-threading. We have in the localization area, of course, KI18N, which is a get text-based translation system. And as I know from the localization people, in many regards, advanced to what Qt is offering. But I think that goes really deeply on which language you can localize in which way, and also for the scripting. Especially the scripting is a really important part there. And we have KUnit conversion, which allows the conversion of different physical units, different unit systems, all boring stuff that you don't want to implement yourself. And I also added the box of Qt widget based or Qt widget extensions, which you probably won't need that often on Android application, maybe for the initial porting, but if you do a GUI for a touch system, you usually don't use Qt widget nowadays, but Qt quick. But in case you really want to use it, you get add-ons to Qt GUI, you get item models, item views, so a lot of extensions to typical cases when you work with widgets, and also for text completion, such widgets. That is something we know that is available today. But only compiling is probably not enough. Or to know that anything compiles, we also need to know that it works. The first step of it is we need it completely integrated in our continuous integration. Of course, we have this container approach where we can simply run KDE source build and we know everything still compiles. However, we want to get it into the CI system, and we are really close to that. I think actually we set everything up that it should work now, whoever. After the last patch, the CI system broke in a way that our Jenkins Docker plugin is not compatible with. Yeah. We have a problem with upstream for the Jenkins Docker integration. Hopefully be fixed soon, but okay, it will be soon fixed. But everything is in place and it should really not work. Actually, we are using the same Docker image we are using for development. So we really share that, and in that way we also ensure that the Docker image is working. If you look into it, you see another second user next to this KDE Android user, namely the Jenkins user who we use for the Jenkins ones. The more pressing question is, I think, the unit testing frameworks, and there we are also quite close. What we do with want to do with unit tests. Of course, we run them already on the other platforms, but we also want to run them on Android. And that's a little bit harder than just running it on Linux, for example. Since we have to pack the unit test into an APK file, get all the startup information to know that there's an executable unit test that we want to run, upload it into an emulator, trigger the start, store the output at some file, and download it again from the emulator, and finally look at what did we get out of it. That's a long round trip, and we finally have all pieces together that, it were several lines of Perl script, but what we have in place now is that we are parsing the C-test output. It's probably not the best way. Hopefully later it will be in the toolchain directly that we get a nice make test target. But currently we are doing it that way to really know that it's working. So we are parsing the C-test files, find out which tests do we have. For each test we create the necessary files, package the APK, upload it, run it, download it, hopefully it doesn't take too long and we get it. Unfortunately, everything with the emulator is taking some time. And it is at least successfully tested with Attica, the smallest framework with only one unit test. The other ones will probably follow next week during the Academy buffs. That's so far what we have in place, and that's where we have to do more. But I think we are in a really good position now. And that's what is currently mostly on the agenda. What I already said, I would like to see a better CMake toolchain integration for unit testing. We are doing a lot of stuff twice, since we are doing it on the one hand in the toolchain, on the other hand, we are doing it in my unit testing framework, since it's a hazard to do this C-test integration, but I think we should achieve doing that also direct in the toolchain, that we have an easier way to get a testing target. However, that's nice to have at the end of point. The more important, the more major challenges are that we have to finish our CI integration and getting the unit tests automatically run and see that hopefully everything is green. I expect some tests probably to fail. However, due to our work on other platforms, I think the most problems should be solved by right now. Especially problems where you are missing files that must be included, since we are nowadays using a lot of Qt resources, that since we had such problems on other platforms, and now we probably get only the Android-specific parts. There's a framework called KNewStuff that is a really high-level framework to only upload and download new stuff, new cool stuff for your application, like training data for an EDU application or wallpapers or such stuff with a really nice, convenient API, and that is used in a lot of KDE applications, but which is, I think, a TSV framework that depends on a lot of other frameworks, especially also KIO, and that makes it really hard to provide an Android. Currently, there's an effort to split this framework into two frameworks. One is a core framework that does only, well, provide a nice interface, for example, for Qt Quick, to integrate into application, doesn't use KIO, and makes it really simple to well, to get the core functionality integrated in the application. And the widget stuff stays in another framework. With that, we hopefully will soon have a solution to catering that use case. And another really big issue is, of course, KIO, since it uses a lot of dbus. And dbus is an extreme problem on Android, since we don't have dbus and we won't get it. But we only have other inter-process communication protocols. Namely, there's Binder, and Binder is using a completely different approach. Dbus is roughly working like a network and sending tasks somewhere, and they are getting to queues, and then they are processed. Binder is a function call. You call something, and then at the other process, something happens. And so you see it's a really different approach, and it will take a lot of effort to see if we can integrate such a mechanism really into KIO. And I really didn't look into it yet, and I think it will be hard if it will be possible.
One thing that you have to realize is that KIO does use dbus, but only for extra stuff like cookies and whatever, right? The actual communication between the application and the slave does not use dbus, it uses a local socket. But even that is a problem on Android, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah. Also, the socket communication is a problem, yeah. I think that there are two steps. We first have to look at what to do about dbus, and second, how to share this information that we exchanged there.
But this might be an easier path then to if Binder is the way to have inter-process communication, then you could first look at an alternative transport for the commands to the slave, having Binder instead of the local socket. That is a much smaller problem because it's a set of well-defined commands which really look like function calls before you go and attack dbus, which is a lot more, right? We even generate code out of the dbus interfaces, and that's going to be a much bigger problem, whereas just the commands to the slave and the answers is just packets on a socket, right?
Yeah.
So that should be easier.
I think it will get the main priority once we have the CI system completely in place, then that we have to look at that problem and see how to address it.
Of course, it would be even better if qlocal socket would use Binder.
Yeah. Okay, but I think I'm done with my talk. I think
do we have time more questions?
Yeah.
Anyone? More questions?
I think we have a lot of documentation on the websites. There you can see a lot. You can find me the next day, and I think until Wednesday at the Academy. If you have any other questions, and probably we'll also make a buff to talk a little about such issues, probably also about the CI integration. But there was still a question.
What motivated you to work on this? Is it a specific application?
Well, in the beginning, it was a specific application. I wanted to get Articulate working on Android, and that was 2 years ago.
Yeah. Yeah, well.
And now I'm still stuck at getting KNU stuff working on Android. But once we have that, I hopefully will see Articulate there. But that's a usual case. Android is providing us with a really big opportunity to get such a big audience that is not available on Linux currently. And smartphone users are, to get them really easy to test stuff and to get give fast feedback. And we already have some applications KDE that get big audience there. For example, J'ai compris. So I think getting a really big audience, and that's awesome.
Yeah.
Okay. I guess that's it. Thank you, Andreas.
Okay. Thank you all for coming.